What episode are we on?
Episode 7.
7? I thought we were...
No. We never know. We never get it right.
I think you get it right every time, and I always get it wrong.
Yeah. I think that's definitely more the trend. We got Lauren here, too.
Hello.
Hello, world.
Hello, world. That's the classic thing you program.
Yeah. When you first start.
Yeah, when you're coding.
That's true.
Print.
Hello, world. Hashtag learn to code.
Hashtag learn to code.
Okay, so we're back. Topics for the week. Care to comment?
Yeah, I think we're going to do a roundup.
Let's just do a programming note.
Yeah.
I want to do a programming note.
Okay, programming note.
Because we are going to do a roundup episode this week, which is Iran.
Yeah.
Post-analysis, following up our two weeks ago hot takes. We were worked up last 2 weeks ago. We really were.
I thought the world was ending.
Yeah, and so now we have to have a little cool down and like review what our takes were. We can do a conversation regarding the latest and greatest in the nomination circus.
Yeah, Democratic primaries.
Maybe some
some Iowa polls.
Yeah, and hot takes. We'll give our predictions.
Yeah.
Okay.
Well, I don't want to get ahead of us, but I do think the primary is sort of over. I don't know if you saw, but New York Times locked in their Klobuchar endorsement, so I think it's pretty much it.
Yeah.
Like, President Klobuchar. we can get to that.
Yeah, we can get to that. I do like this. It has a nice ring to it, though. President Klobuchar. It sounds like Star Trek or something.
Yeah, it does.
You know, like Klobuchar is like just a very stately name.
Interesting that they gave their endorsement to someone who's not even really reporting in the polls right now.
Yeah, well, she's got a solid...
Solid
5%.
Okay. Back to the programming note.
Okay.
This week we're going to do a roundup episode. I think down the road the fans want a dedicated climate change.
Yeah. People have been clamoring for it.
I've heard a lot of requests from the audience for this episode. We have a lot of hot takes to deliver. It's going to have to be a recurring series, obviously, given that this is not going away.
It's a major existential problem.
So that's definitely coming to works.
I do want to talk about that Friends and article so bad.
I know, but I really do. So we'll
do climate change another time. Yeah, it's definitely on the list.
I think that's definitely on the list. So for the people that requested that, don't worry, we're not running from that terrifying topic. We will tackle it head on.
Yeah.
But not this week.
Not this week.
This week's been a little bit tumultuous for us both personally.
Yeah.
Actually, all three of us personally. Lauren, too.
Mm-hmm. For sure.
Well, we can get to that. Because that actually leads into my next point on the programming note. I want to do an episode on, quote, personal capitalism, or the internal, provisional name for the concept of like the way in which we all personally, especially I think our generation, are confined by like kind of the nature of our system and like the lives we think are available to us. We get like morphed into this very narrow view of what's available to us because of the way the world we live in.
Yeah, the economy we were born
that is very
into.
Quite. Not it's obviously not true, but we kind of get. So I want to have to do a whole episode on this thing.
Okay.
Taking all three of our conversations, we just had like a 2-hour pre-podcast, personal life rundown, but basically taking that what we were all facing and making it into a generic concept and talking about how that's like.
Yeah.
What we think about that as a generic concept. So that's another episode.
Yeah.
Just as a teaser right there for the audience.
Yeah.
So you'll have to tune in to episode 9 or 10 or something like that, if you want to get those hot takes. Okay.
So this week, Iran, Democratic primaries, and then I'm going to make Cy react to impeachment updates that he hasn't read anything about.
Well, yeah, I've seen the headlines, but...
That's all I've
but
seen.
But, you know, they all blur together now. Okay. You know, that's the real quality analysts only read headlines.
Yeah. That's modern-day academic political researching. Yeah.
There is something to be said for that. We can go into them. We can have a methodological discussion about headline reading as well.
Yeah.
Okay. So we've got a bunch of content for this week.
Yeah. Okay. So let's start with Iran. Obviously, the world didn't end. World War III didn't happen. Iran did strike back. Where we left off, we had done the assassination.
We were waiting for the strike back.
Yeah.
And it happened.
Oh, and also a quick note on the last episode. I just said a bunch of stuff wrong about the history of Iran. So, just I don't even want to. I don't have a list in front of me or anything, but I can
just apologize.
I will just blanket apology for all the Iranian history that I got like horrific
that we butchered. And that goes for all of us in general.
Yeah, we don't. We're not experts. Honestly.
Yeah, this isn't our day job. Please don't have us.
Not our day job. And I think you know what? Actually, I might back out of that apology.
It's an apology, and I'm gonna apologize for the apology, and I'm gonna then come back with a reactionary. No, in fact, I'm not apologizing.
Yeah, you know what? In fact, you guys should apologize to me.
Yeah.
How about that? You know,
you should be thanking me for giving you incorrect information. And you having to go through the process of correcting and therefore learning,
that's what life's about, honestly. You know, why Google when you can speculate?
Yeah.
How about that?
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
Wow.
So,
good take.
Iran was not in the Ottoman Empire. Do you know that?
Yeah. That was the big one. That was the big one. We both did it. We weren't sure about that. Well, that goes to the depth and the history of the Iranian, you know, kingdom, the nation.
Yeah.
Or the civilization is that they've been this independent civilization for so long. You know, it's kind of like China in that sense, like the length of this as an independent, like, people is pretty impressive.
Yeah, definitely.
Various iterations of, you know, iterations of different types of whatever, but, like, you know, not even the English people, you know, the English people haven't existed that long as a people.
Yeah,
right?
Yeah.
You know, or the, generic people X traditionally don't last this long, whereas the... Iranian Persian people have been around since literally the beginning of time.
Yeah.
Beginning
of recorded history.
Misuse of the word literally there, so I apologize to the people for that.
No. literally means figuratively now, according to, I think, most dictionaries. Yeah, Merriam-Webster.
So, okay, that's one of the topic.
Yeah.
The use and abuse of the English language.
So we assassinate Soleimani. I thought... this was going to lead to
catastrophic
escalation back and forth. Trump, you know,
you did have a wish for a show of stately restraint, royal high ground restraint from Iran.
And they did seem to lean into that. They did, you know, I mean, they obviously did strike back. So they sent a bunch of missiles to hit a base in Iraq. So great. I think our boss at work was joking about it or said something online where it's like, you know, U.S. attacks Iran in Iraq. Iran responds by attacking U.S. in Iraq.
Yeah.
And it's just like Iraq is just like where the bodies pile up. Unfortunately, that's just like the part of the world that we're using to wage this sort of proxy war.
And you know that actually that has historical precedent, unfortunately, for the Iraqi people.
Yeah, yeah, the Iraqi people are just caught in the middle of it. I feel bad for countries like Iraq. I mean, countries like the Ukraine who just get embroiled in our shit, and we're just. We're fighting our dumb political battles, domestic political battles, over which side, and and these countries are just trying to be countries.
Getting whiplashed,
yeah.
It's like, I'd like to, you know, kind of have debates over, you know, fiscal policy.
Yeah.
That'd be nice.
Yeah. And not whether I support.
Let's like,
US
yeah, let's yell at each
not.
Other over guns rights. Like, let's have that. That'd be a good conversation to have instead of.
Whether we support the U.S. troops here
or the Iranian
troops
here.
Yeah. So Iran launched a bunch of missiles at an U.S. base in Iraq.
Two U.S. bases got hit. Key points are two U.S. bases got hit. No American casualties. Though I did read a report that some American troops suffered concussions.
I saw an inflammatory Washington Post headline.
Trump lied.
Yeah, Trump lied. It wasn't a safe...
Honestly, Washington Post, please, like, just fuck off.
Yeah.
Like, no one died. No one else cares about the details. Like,
for
honestly,
all intents and purposes, incredible restraint by Iran.
Yeah, and also the other key headline is that, on the meme of headlines, is that Iran or someone informed the Iraqi government ahead of time.
Yeah.
That these strikes were coming, and somehow the U.S. knew these strikes were coming. So the Americans on these bases had cleaned up the base, got all these, like, sophisticated equipment hidden away under bunkers, and all, like, chilling in bunkers when these things hit.
Yeah.
So it was, like, and of course, I think the point there is, I mean, the speculation is that someone in Iran, by design, leaked this so that no Americans would be killed.
Yeah. They're not trying to get into a war.
Well,
right
they're
now.
Trying to satisfy the need
political
to
requirement to respond against a foreign
exactly.
Power,
but they also showing that restraint, and so a nice little display of statesmanship there, or at least not so about statesmanship, but threading the needle.
Yeah, they did. Yeah, they did a good job.
And also then Trump also He said if Iran responds, we're going to hit 52 sites or something idiotic like that.
And they did respond,
but of course we didn't respond back. So Trump also backed off and said Iran's standing down.
Yeah.
Took it as a win and said, okay, now the parties have kind of backed off and we're kind of at this.
Is no one talking about the repercussions of the fact that they accidentally shot down a civilian plane?
That's a good point, Lauren. Yeah, that's like the other huge thing that happened was during this, in between the time when Iran launched those strikes and we had assassinated Soleimani, Ukrainian plane again. Ukraine just didn't get the memo and just tried to fly over Iranian airspace, and Iran shot that shit down. And
Iranian
killed everyone.
The IRGC, so the revolutionary a unit from the IRGC, which I think is important because it wasn't the generic Iranian military unit. It was an IRGC unit, which makes it even more politically sensitive. Shot down the plane. Of course, Iran covered it up to begin with, said it wasn't us.
Blah, blah, blah. I got nothing to see here.
And then, of course, very quickly, U.S. and Canada and so on and so forth said, I'll get this picture. Essentially, like, I caught you. And, of course, so it came out. Big internal repercussions in Iran.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Which I think, so, you know, I think it's fortunate in some sense. Obviously, it's a tragedy.
Yeah.
But in this, Trump has stumbled into, the U.S. and this, whatever, the administration has stumbled into a stroke of luck here in the sense that this has put additional pressure on the regime internally.
Yeah.
Whereas there was this fear of, like, intense unification behind the regime.
Yeah, because in response to Soleimani assassination.
This has fractured that
immediately.
And now there's protests back in the street and the police are killing the protesters and right back to where we were a few months ago.
Yeah.
And so... All of a sudden, you look at the calculus now, and for Trump, and he's like, "We took out this quote bad guy. We, you know, and this other quote, you know, the two guys, both Soleimani and also the guy
no one knows the name of,
but he who is the head of the militias in Iraq.
Yeah.
So we got these two guys off. We get to claim the win. We took Iran didn't strike back in any meaningful way, and Iran's still internally chaotic. And so the score sheet for Trump, he's got to be like. Looking at this going, wow, this was a huge win.
Yeah, I mean, the American press will give him no credit because they...
Of course, I do think, you know, if objectively, this looks good from his view.
Yeah.
And I think you have to be able to say, like, and we're not in war. We're not in war. So he
we're
managed
not war
to, like...
Iran. We ratcheted up pressure on the Ayatollah. The Iranian people are protesting. We have, you know...
And we established, like, some, like...
sanctions.
Yeah, we've established this level of, like, you know, quote, deterrence. You know, remember we were shitting on Petraeus?
Yeah.
Last episode because he was like, Trump has reestablished deterrence, but it's like... In some sense, it looks that way. Now, he may have got lucky with the airliner. I'm like, that's why I think partially he got lucky with that.
Yeah.
Terribly lucky, tragically lucky, obviously. But I think objectively, you have to look at it and go, it looks pretty good for him now.
Yeah. And the question is, where does U.S.-Iran relations go from here, right? And I think of note, you know, Saudi Arabia has been very, very quiet. You know, I think all the major powers in the Middle East have been just
Israel's been quiet.
Everyone's just sort of been like, let's just see how this shakes out. And it's shaking out, I think, you know, to the detriment of Iran. So Iran, you know, lost this charismatic guy. And we were talking about it sort of before the podcast, earlier in the week about... Is Soleimani replaceable or not?
To what degree is like he uniquely capable of like fielding Iran's strategy, tactics in the Middle East?
Yeah, the Iranian policy
and
in the
being
region.
This agent of quote chaos. If you're from our end, or you know,
resistance
from the Iranian view.
So I mean, there's a chance that like the militia groups from Hamas, Hezbollah, you know, to all the other PMUs within Iraq and
the Houthis
all of these conflicts that are happening in the region that Iran was backing and has its fingers in and had Soleimani sort of organizing that organizing effort, you have to imagine has diminished considerably without this guy being there.
Yeah.
And you have to imagine that that's going to lead to a diminishment of the importance of some of these groups and their ability to exert Iranian influence in the region has probably been you know, decrease significantly again, which is a win for Trump, which is a win for the Trump administration.
And their view of the way that their analysis, perception of the reality in the Middle East, it's like they're looking at this going, this is a huge win.
Yeah. So, I think where we go from here, I mean, Trump is talking about...
Of course, like, he's always saying, let's make a deal.
Let's get back, let's do a new deal. We need the European countries to come back, we need Russia and China. Let's, come on, the last deal was bad. Now that I've escalated shit, I've ratcheted up the pressure, there's Iranian protests, let's have a new deal.
Yeah.
Let's have a new nuclear deal.
And of course, Iran says no, because they can't. You know, from that kind of internal political view, it's like, that would look... But.
So I mean, I don't think a deal is dead. I don't think a nuclear deal happens. So where does this go from here? I mean, Iran's already said we're going to start developing weapons. European countries who were in the treaty have, you know, publicly stated that Iran is now violating the terms of that initial treaty.
Yep.
They are enriching uranium again. They are going to try to develop nuclear weapons again.
So we're going to get back to that place. Internally. Yeah, we're going to get back to that place where, I mean, it's hard to remember now, but 5 years ago, maybe pre-Iran deal, pre the negotiations, because there's about like 2 years of negotiations to get to that signing, right?
Yeah.
There was a point where it was like, yo, Israel's about to bomb the shit out of Iran, because they, you know, from Israel's point of view, like, existentially, Iran can't get a bomb. That's like their point of view. If they get a bomb,
Moment on that, do you think if Iran developed a bomb back then, like, they would have dropped it on Israel?
It does seem absolutely insane, but it doesn't...
Seems like rhetoric.
You don't have to drop the bomb for the bomb to be effective as a weapon.
Yeah.
The threat of the bomb, the possibility of a bomb changes everything. And even if you're... forget the Israeli-Iranian kind of conflict. I mean, if Iran has a bomb, probably Saudi Arabia is going to try to get a bomb.
Yeah.
They want a bomb, they can get it. You know, like, they're going to get it. You know, it's just the way it works, unfortunately.
Yeah.
Iran can do it. North Korea can do it. Pakistan can do it. It's like...
Eventually, everyone's going to have a bomb, right?
Which is terrifying.
The science has, like, been established for 100 years.
It's not rocket... It really isn't really that complicated.
Yeah. It literally is rocket science, but it's not...
turns out rocket science isn't that complicated.
Yeah, rocket science isn't that complicated anymore.
Coming from the PhD in chemistry. Yeah. It is complicated for me, but not so much for Trevor.
No.
Yeah, so going back to what comes forward next, we talked about it. It's funny. Maybe Trump plays bad cop, scraps the old deal. We sanctions, maximum resistance, kill the Soleimani, blah, 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 blah. Very hard to imagine an Iranian regime at this stage coming to the table. But maybe Trump gets out of office and the Democrat gets to comes in and says, let's make a deal now. Being a good, quote, good cop. And politically, it's possible now to make a new deal.
Yeah, and then Iran can save face and say, you know what? We resisted Trump. Trump was the asshole continuing American imperialism.
But it's different with Democrat X, you know?
Yeah,
and,
yeah.
Of course, it depends on who the Democrat is. And
it depends on how domestic politics shake out in Iran.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm really wondering... I mean, they quelled the protests that were sort of bubbling 6 months ago.
Yep.
They shut off the internet. They did a bunch of crazy shit to maintain their, like, lockdown theocracy within that country.
Yep.
The sanctions aren't going anywhere, so the economic conditions of Iran are going to continue to deteriorate on the ground. The U.S., I mean, you know, I've talked about it at least, and I think, like, sanctions are a form of warfare, obviously, and they're a form of warfare that you can think of as being peaceful in that bombs aren't dropping, we're not destroying
but
museums
certainly
and hospitals.
Ethically ambiguous.
Yeah, ethically ambiguous at best. I mean, you are hurting the poorest people in Iran. Like, sanctions do not hurt the Ayatollah except
directly
by first hurting the poor people, hoping that the poor people then become so enraged at their leadership that they hurt the Ayatollah. That's how sanctions work politically, and that's how we're currently wielding sanctions, is we're ratcheting up that pressure on the Iranian administration to by hurting the people who, you know, need the help the most in that country and who would benefit the most, you know, the ones that we say, the good Iranians who want democracy, we're sort of fostering that by making it...
Just so that people know out there, there's a lot of quotes coming in here for Trevor, quote, democracy, the quote, you know.
Yeah. But, I mean, so it remains to be seen whether the Ayatollah... I mean... To what extent can an Ayatollah-led theocratic regime like last in a modern?
Well, that's what we always say. It's like, how long can any dictatorship last? They're bound to crumble. That's what you know. It's like a kind of a.
They all have.
They all have. You know, communist China's lasted for
Less than 100 years.
Yeah, coming up to their 100-year kind of, that's one of the big things that she's, like, 100-year mark is, like...
And they started liberalizing until she came in and started, like, ratchet, you know.
So, yeah, the question is how... And, I mean, especially, China has a lot of things going for it that Iran doesn't, right?
Yeah.
She's bigger and has more leverage, X, Y, and Z.
North Korea is another, you know, you could, I think Iran and North Korea is
like,
similar in that way. Where
there's no reason to suspect that, you know, it would last. There's no, you know, eventually most things crumble, you know, things fall apart. Like,
yeah.
That's in the, and
especially
under
the,
pressure.
The pressure of modernity.
Yeah.
The pressure of like social media and like technology, and you look at like these modern economies everywhere, and then you look at
Iran. And even in the Middle East, like the Arab Spring, you know, right? Like,
yeah.
A lot of long lasting regimes fell to
yeah.
that, and that was like fairly organic, you know, just social media, stagnation of living standards, lack of democracy, blah blah blah, in Tunisia, in Libya,
yeah.
and you know, it's happening in Algeria currently to some degree. There's these massive protesting that's happening now, you know, Syria or whatever. So, and it didn't happen in Iran, but there's no reason to think that it couldn't happen down the road.
What do you think is best case scenario for the Iranian people?
Well, of course, a liberal Western liberal democracy.
Yeah.
Of course, Trevor. That is obviously the best thing for all humans.
Yeah, and how does that
Can't
happen?
You tell?
How does that happen? How does that happen in Iran?
No, I mean,
quickest path
here's the fact of the matter is that there's no democracies, there's no history of real tradition of democracy.
In Iran.
And really not in the Middle East broadly.
Yeah.
Right?
It's a very Western thing.
You know, Turkey has a functioning... You know, arguably a functioning democracy. Obviously, it's under pressure from Erdogan, but Turkey's different from, you know, Turkey has a much more Western.
Yeah, cosmopolitan.
You know, there's tradition there, and there's the, you know, the history of Turkey is really interesting where this guy came in. I'm trying to think of his name, I can't think of it right now, but the guy who basically took over Turkey and secularized it and Westernized it after the Ottomans fell apart.
Yeah.
Can't think of his name. Post World War II. Came in, secularized, and kind of westernized Turkey to a large degree, and established what we now know of as modern Turkey.
Can that happen in Iran? Can you get, like, I mean, the Ayatollah himself has to die at some point, right?
Yeah, he's aging, and
he's a pretty old dude. And
but
like,
they have had a succession. The first Ayatollah also, Grand Ayatollah, passed at some point, too, and this is the second.
Yeah.
So there's a history of succession there, but that's where, you know, risky. That's, you'd expect that to be a point where it could crumble.
Yeah.
And, I think the best case scenario for the Iranian people and people across the world would be, a decay of those institutions and maybe...
A natural decay.
But I just think there's too much... The thing with that is that the IRGC is this armed force. And not only are they armed and deadly, obviously, but they have massive financial stakes in the economy. They own and have their branches of that organization, I don't know the details of it, but have vast business interests in Iran, in the oil and the chemicals and all the major industries. And so it's not just ideological, you know, Islamic revolutionary ideology going on there. There's also dollars at stake, which obviously at the end of the day motivates most stuff, unfortunately.
And if they had a
that's
bomb,
what you're seeing in
if
like
they got a bomb, then it just legitimizes the those in power.
Well, you're seeing it in Venezuela, right? Like Venezuela.
Yeah.
The military in Venezuela is basically a armed
political group,
and they own, they have business interests.
Yeah.
The military leaders have business interests.
Yeah.
And the military is basically just an armed branch, security branch of that.
Yeah.
And so because the military will not flip sides. Because the military is the status quo, you know, like they are the ones who have the interest that would be toppled by a new regime, like a Western liberal regime, I guess. They're not going to flip sides. If the army is separate and that does not have financial stake, then they could theoretically switch sides.
Yeah.
To maintain the, you know, but I don't see that happening.
Governments have gone through that transition though. Like Brazil, the, you know, military was, you know, similarly had
it's
that
true,
sort of economic
possible.
Power.
It's certainly a lot of the Latin American, you know, Chile with Pinochet successfully transitioned. It's unusual. You know, that's a whole other fascinating discussion about Pinochet.
to what degree did he enable that? You know, which would be like kind of, which is unusual from a dictator standpoint. But yeah, I don't know. I think short term, I think probably it's just a standoff. I think the best hope for progress to be made is when, if and when a Democrat gets elected.
And then they go back to the bargaining table and say, hey, let's just, you know, they're back channeling with the Ayatollahs.
So, another interesting little point that's happened over the last time we talked is the king of Oman died.
Oh, I didn't know this.
So the king of Oman, you know, Oman's like a small country south of Saudi Arabia on the peninsula there next to Yemen. You know, absolute ruler, monarchy type situation as well. But he's been the ruler of Oman for about 50 years now. And he like really modernized the country and like he's been like very well respected. And he's played like a new, he's maintained their neutrality. So he's not part of like this, like the Saudi like group.
Coalition, yeah.
But he's also not like an Iranian puppet. And so he's been a back channel. He was this king and his diplomatic functionaries were key to setting up the back channels that set up the initial negotiations for the first Iran deal.
Yeah, that's interesting.
And so that neutrality was like, he was always been kind of a peacemaker there. He's passed. It's a stable, I think it's a stable transition in the sense that he's named his successor and that person's coming in and but you never know. Like that next person might be,
take that sweet Saudi money.
Yeah, I mean, it might be an MBS type character or who knows, you know, either way, maybe that he's pro-Iran and they go with the Iran. There's a potential where that stability of a neutral force to kind of help facilitate talks isn't there anymore, which
I mean there's always
there's
like,
just like that human
there's
element
always the
of
Nordic
this.
The Nordic neutrals, you know, I mean I
which,
saw that
which,
like
which are can be helpful, but that's the beauty of Oman is that they're there, they have
exactly,
you know, they have relationships, the human nature of the diplomacy actually has to happen, right? Like you have to have these people meet and like not yell at each other, right? Which is like fascinating that this at the micro level you need these kind of facilitators to get to the macro fucking nuclear deal part two, version two.
So as long as if Oman may or may not play that role in the future, but we're thinking that things are going to pretty much hold steady. There's not going to be any more real escalation. Probably
Hopefully.
The militia units are going to consolidate in some way and, you know, sort of
I think that's what we
stop
talk about
being
that.
As active.
In Iraq, the parliament voted to a non-binding kind of resolution to have all foreign troops leave the nation, country, and after we killed Soleimani.
Yeah, but you saw it was kind of weird because
it's not binding.
The parliament wasn't there.
Yeah, all the Sunnis and Kurds
were like, we're not participating.
We're boycotting it because they kind of were the ones who opposed Iranian influence.
Yeah,
and therefore, tacitly, support American influence.
Yeah,
because they're a counterweight. So that the politics of Iraq are not so black and white as all Iraqis want Americans to leave.
And
it's
the prime minister is the one who like sort of spurred that on, but he's like he's a caretaker.
Yeah,
prime
and
minister.
He's trying to balance all these competing forces as well.
Yeah.
So we haven't left Iraq.
Haven't left. And Trump, in fact, was like, we're not leaving. Iraq said, like, please leave in response.
Yeah.
And then Trump was essentially like, if you try to force us out, we're going to make you pay for these bases.
Yeah.
We're going to just start putting sanctions on you. We're just going to trade war you. How about that?
Yeah.
How about that, Iraq?
You want to go the route of Iran? Oh,
yeah.
Good fucking luck.
You want to tell us to leave? We're not leaving.
Which I think my view, it's best case. Like, I think it would be terrible for the Iraqi people for American troops to leave. Or potentially. Now let me paint that scenario. What we're seeing in Lebanon right now, where you have a non-functioning government incapable of providing even basic services, garbage pickup, electricity, basic rule of law in Lebanon now. Massive protests happening in Lebanon, like Arab Spring-style protests, police shooting people in the streets, beating people, you know, generic. The Lebanese government is paralyzed because half the state is run by Hezbollah.
Yeah.
The military is only half the country. The rest of it is run by Hezbollah's military branch and Hezbollah's business interests and political interests. And and the country is paralyzed. Whether you think the ideological, you know, resistance against Israel thing is legit, whatever, set that aside. The point is having this shadow government of a foreign nation whose interests lie with the foreign nation and whose direction comes from this foreign nation is terrible for the people of Lebanon.
So Iraq doesn't have a Hezbollah.
Doesn't have that, but the What do you... I view the PMUs, these militia units, as Iran's army in...
But they're not as consolidated. They don't have the same history. They don't have the political...
Totally. It's very different. But the analogy remains is, yeah, is if American sure. troops leave, American troops leave, there's this armed wing in Iraq that is commanded by Iranian generals, basically, and reports to Iranian, commands, and has, they have their parliament, they have people in parliament that are basically...
Iranian puppets.
Yeah, you know, but that are basically the political side of the PMUs, right? That's where that could go. Very, very easily, I view that.
It is possibly.
I mean, obviously, there's a lot of
things. The thing is with Iran now, I mean, Hezbollah is sort of established now. Hezbollah's like a political force.
But that 1980, that's... Iran founded Hezbollah.
They did.
This is tried and true playbook.
Iran is not 80s Iran right now, right? Totally. We're just talking about what, you have to think about holistically in Iranians' domestic politics right now, where you have a sizable population.
Yeah.
I think it's safe to say, and we said this last time, most Iranians probably vary against the Soleimani killing. Maybe, this is a political figure in our country, is an assassination.
You can't kill us, whatever.
But I think there's also this sizable population there that is wants to modernize, wants to join the world stage.
I mean,
rejects the Ayatollahs
and rejects the Islamic fundamentalism. Wants to be able to women want to be able to not wear headscarves, right?
Exactly.
I don't think those are mutually exclusive.
No, they're not. These are just
internally
sort of influence.
Iran has its own crazy complex politics,
and
just
so
like
they're
we do.
Sanctioned. Yeah. They're sanctioned. They want to ramp up their nuclear program. They just lost their chief strategist.
Yeah.
The Ayatollah's political power is sort of
suspect.
Suspect right now. Is this? Can he really wage
pull that off
an
in
Iraqi
Iran.
Influence campaign of the magnitude needed to say no? Iraq is now just Iran's little brother. I don't think so. I don't think there is that political clout. I don't think there's that economic capability.
Truly,
I agree. That threat is there.
I think it behooves us to try to keep that from happening. Not just pull out and say, looking at the analysis, because no matter how much analysis you do, you don't know.
Do you think the only way to keep that from happening is to have American troops there?
I don't know. No, I don't believe that. But I do believe American troops certainly are one way to help mitigate that in some way, if done correctly, right? Obviously, take Trump out of the equation, but just in general, that's certainly a way to promote influence and to exercise influence and power. And for example, we train the Iraqi army. That keeps the Iraqi army from becoming, theoretically, it helps the Iraqi army be a counterweight to the PMUs, right?
Right.
Or stuff like that helps. So I don't know that...
And the PMUs have to run... Do the PMUs have the same sort of economic... They don't have, the economic clout that, Hezbollah has, right?
Well...
I mean, maybe they're getting money
newer.
From Iran, hemorrhaging money right
and,
now.
Of course, and also the PMUs, I think there's a couple of things that don't... Number one, Iraq's massive relative to Lebanon.
Yeah.
Huge.
Yeah.
Two, there's a history of antagonism between the Iraqi people and Iranian people in the sense of the Iraq-Iran war.
Yeah.
So there's a nationalism, anti-Iranian nationalism that exists that probably didn't exist in Lebanon that allowed them to kind of sneak in a little bit easier.
Yeah.
And there isn't the motivating ideological struggle of the Israel right next door, which is the foundational premise of Hezbollah.
Right.
So there's a lot of reasons why that analogy doesn't work, I admit. But I think it's important to keep in mind in the sense that that playbook exists. If Iran could, that's what they would do.
Yeah, I think to your point, Iran's number one foreign policy goal is to get the United States out of Iraq. So they can exert their own influence over...
And run their own little...
Yeah,
do whatever the fuck they want to do.
Yeah, so that's it would be very much to, the goals of the Ayatollah and the Iranian regime for the U.S. to pull out of Iraq.
Yeah.
And for us to say, we're going to take a back seat and just provide funding...
Infrastructure
projects. Yeah, or even just cut ties completely and say,
you just have our embassy there and be like, all right, you're just like anybody else. Good luck.
Yeah.
Let us know if you call. Give us a call. I think it's very attractive, get our troops out of Iraq, blah, blah, blah. Domestically, too. I think we'll pivot to. But that's the constraints of, foreign policy. It's very tricky dilemmas that if you're interested in what's good for the Iraqi people, right? Which I think.
Yeah.
We are with coming from that angle.
So that's where I'm trying to come from. It's what do Iraqis want? And I know most Iraqis would love to have a functioning nation state that represents the Iraqi people.
That's sovereign.
Yeah, the lights come on every night. People
and
can
there's
go
no
to
sectarian
jobs.
Conflict.
They
like
don't have to worry.
Basic stuff.
Yeah, no sectarian conflict. It's not an Iranian puppet government, and it's not a U.S. puppet government. Some self-determined.
That's
Iraqi,
all there. But
that's what they want. How does that happen?
How do you get there?
How do you get there? I mean,
and to what degree can any American policy really facilitate that? Or should, you know, should we just wash our hands of it and say, you know, whatever?
Yeah.
I don't think washing our hands of it and just pulling out and saying good luck is as ethically superior as it might appear in the first glance. It's superior because, like, we, you know, get our troops out of there. War is bad. Blah blah blah. Yes, there's a moral value there, but I also think just
I think it creates less antagonism too. I think it creates less conflict.
De-escalation.
It de-escalates
begins,
a lot of
totally.
Stuff.
But
yeah.
also just
yeah.
you know it doesn't you know it isn't necessarily gonna solve the problems and
no.
like it's
I
not
mean,
as
I,
it's,
I think
and,
we
and
owe
running,
to them to invest a ton of money.
I do too.
And American tax dollars.
But also just sending money doesn't work either.
No, no,
right?
I know,
you can't
I know.
Nation build and you know look at Afghanistan. You know it's like you just
Iraq's
bombing
different
them with
than Afghanistan.
Totally.
Yeah.
I'm just saying like. Obviously, but there's no version of us just pulling out and be like, here's $500 billion. Like,
no.
That money's just going to go to the corrupt leadership, and the people are going to go, wait a minute, like,
yeah.
here we are.
Yeah.
So that's, it's just hard.
Yeah.
There's no silver bullet, so.
Things are looking bleak for Iraq,
for the people.
As they have been for the last couple decades.
But I do think.
But it is nice that I think the Iranian crisis, if you want to call it that,
yeah.
over the last few weeks,
is looking
I'm glad,
less ugly.
I'm glad the temperature has come down
totally.
A bit there.
That
I think that's
be.
Just great for the world. I genuinely thought in my heart of hearts that this was going to ratchet up. And even if not 100% chance that was going to happen, I thought that was like 70% we're at least going to get, Iran's going to kill some Americans, we're going to kill some Iranians.
Yeah.
It's going to go tit for tat until eventually we hit some sort of like, you know, war or no war period. I did not expect it to just
simmer.
To simmer so quickly. I did see another article too. I mean, we were talking about, you know, Iran maybe let us know that they were going to launch the missiles. I also saw something that like we back channeled through the Swiss that like, hey, please don't like kill Americans, please, because we want like it was American foreign policy and American State Department officials. I think maybe even unbeknownst to Trump,
what it's like,
we don't know what he's going to do.
But
just
it's
like,
going to get ugly.
It's going to get ugly. Like, please just keep your response measured, and we will do everything we can to keep our response measured.
Yeah.
Like, both sides
be like,
were like,
wait, we got these hotheads up here.
Yeah,
in the trenches.
And Trump literally tweeting at each
in
other.
In the diplomatic
right
trenches, people are like
yeah,
working
exactly.
to like, keep
the state,
these.
The state officials from both countries and all the European countries involved,
yeah.
everyone's just like, please, U.S., please, Iran, don't do what it looks like you're about to do.
Yeah, yeah.
And
which,
I'm glad they
and they're heroes, unknown heroes.
You
know,
all
you know?
Those people sending all those frantic emails at late hours and shit. Like, thank you for your service. They
yeah.
don't get thanked enough.
Yeah, for sure.
For keeping world peace happening.
It was crazy in that moment. I remember I was sitting in bed. It was at night in the U.S. It was at night when this was happening, when those missile strikes happened.
Yeah, I was like,
and,
here we go.
And I was on Twitter, right?
Yeah.
I'm on Twitter, and I'm like, and dude, if you do, like, if you search, it was the amount of disinformation and misinformation
yeah.
that was, like,
it was like 30
I texted
missiles.
Trevor, I texted you, because I was like, dude, it's happening, because there was reports of, like, people saying, missiles are raining down, mass casualties, like, all these, like,
yeah.
like, American stealth fighter jets are in the air, like, it was all over the, like, and so, like, I, you know, the IRGC that shot down the airliner, right? If any of them were, like, reading fucking Twitter,
yeah.
it looked like, it. I mean, it, you could have read dozens and dozens of tweets that were saying mass casualties, catastrophic damage, American fighter stealth jets are in the air, F-22s are headed to, like, Iraqi airspace now. Like, I was like, oh, it's happening. Like, casualties on our side, we're responding.
Yeah.
Fighter jets are going to get shot down, we're going to bomb them, Tomahawks are flying, here we go, like. The aircraft carriers are getting involved.
It's not going to be in Iran
like,
the way we like. We're
this,
at a turning.
I was. It was like I'm scrolling through, and of course, it ended up being not you know not any of that. You know, no whatever, as we just described. But in the moment, watching that misinformation flow on Twitter, it's as a side note, just
yeah.
like the craziness of Twitter as a. It was mind-blowing.
Thank God that's not what the State Department uses to,
thank God,
to
I mean,
learn facts on the ground.
Yeah, it was nuts. I mean, I was just like, basically, actually, it was funny because I did read the New. I was basically resorted to just seeing what the New York Times was posting because at the
as
very
much
least,
as we shit on them. Yeah.
As much as I shit on the New York Times, like I was like, at the very least, like they're not going to say like so disinformation, you know,
yeah,
like so
yeah.
like. They're gonna report what the Pentagon says, and like at least that's like that's good
yeah.
enough for me at this point because the amount of stuff that I was reading from non check marks, even a few check marks,
yeah,
was crazy.
Yeah,
I was like, I was honestly like,
we're about to see the toppling of the Iranian government. Like the missile, civil war happened.
Like,
in the
this
Middle
is
East.
It. Like, it was, and it was a scary moment.
The IRGC becomes the Shia version of ISIS and starts roaming the Middle East, conquering cities, and
so we'll see.
Back away from that shit.
Okay, let's pivot.
Well, before we pivot, let's just think about. I just want to think about where we stand in the Middle East right now. Because, you know, we were laughing about this, too. I think we both listened to this Fareed Zakaria podcast where he was given the sort of mainstream take on, like, Trump's foreign policy. I do think it's, like, silly to the point of ridiculous to try to, like, frame Trump foreign policy in a coherent...
Coherence.
Like
from a strategic...
Yeah. Here's
like,
someone who thinks deeply about the world and like, here's
and
his,
has
like...
has a theory of foreign policy from first principles in which... And then...
Yeah.
Policy is flowing downstream of first principles.
The way like an Obama or even a Bush administration or like a
conceivably
Fareed,
like at least like, tried to think about the world.
The way the DC crowd thinks about foreign policy to try to frame Trump's foreign policy in that way is honestly hysterical. But so Fareed was just hitting like the main bullet points. He's like, all right, so we pulled out. We left the Kurds. We abandoned the Kurds
in Syria,
because
we don't want to get out of the desert.
We want to get out of the desert. We want to save
bring the
American
troops
lives.
Yeah.
But then we sent those same troops to guard the oil fields in Syria and sent additional troops to Saudi Arabia.
To guard their oil fields.
To guard their oil fields.
But Saudi Arabia paid for it, so it's chill.
Yeah, so Saudi Arabia's paying us. So now our military is just like some mercenary force for Saudi Arabia to protect their oil interests. Trump has literally been saying in press conferences, we'll probably take the oil. I mean, it just makes sense. Like, we're already there.
Why
I don't
not?
Want to fight the wars, but I do want to take the oil. And everyone, even the Fox News hosts are like,
horrified.
Please stop saying this out loud. You're not supposed... This is like a Michael Moore talking point during, like, peak Iraq war.
Yeah.
Like, we're not supposed to say, we're here to take your oil. That's some Hitlerian, like, we're going to establish some world empire shit. You can't...
Sorry, we need your resources.
Yeah, you know, sorry, we're just going to come in and just take your cobalt, China. You know, like, you can't just take resources from a country. And Trump just keeps saying it in press conferences while the Fox News, Fox and Friends hosts are like, well, you know, I know you're saying take the oil, but you don't really mean it. It's like, no, I really mean, like, yeah, we might not, but I think we should. It would pay for itself.
Yeah.
Yeah. We don't want to fight the wars, but, like, we're already there. We got to get the oil. That's the whole reason we're there, right? And everyone's like, no, stop it. Stop saying that. That's supposed to be the quiet part.
That's the classic Trump speaking truth, like, by accident.
Yeah.
And, like, shattering, like, institutional, like...
Yeah, oh, the illusion
like,
of legitimacy
yeah.
of some of our foreign policies.
Yeah.
All this stuff that's been whispered
which,
about.
You know, which,
I mean, which I think is probably good for the country
yeah.
to hear some of this stuff out loud from the president.
The classic Trump, like, stumble. Yeah, it's just hilarious.
Yeah, so we're taking oil, I guess, from some parts of the war-torn Syria.
Well, okay, so let me do my my coherence, exercise in creating some veneer of coherence over this.
We're in Syria. The oil in the northern Syria fields... are northwest Syria, northeast Syria, where we were with the Kurds, right? We helped them conquer all that territory from ISIS. We're like, yo, we're not going to get into the Kurd-Turkey feud.
No.
That's ugly.
Sorry,
we're out.
Yeah.
Sorry, guys, you're on your own.
To the dismay of the Kurdish people.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But, and, you know, and to the applause of our Turkish, quote, ally.
Yeah.
So arguably, it's a tough decision. We've made it. Okay.
Yeah.
Now, there's this oil in Syria. Not a ton, but... oil.
Enough to finance ISIS.
ISIS used it.
Yeah.
To great effect. Sold it to Turkey. Turkey was like, fuck yeah. So we could give it, or we could let Assad get it. It's arguable to say it's good policy, because if anybody gets the oil, it's best that we get it. Now, hear me out. I'd rather us get it than Assad.
So what does it even mean for us to get the oil? Because it's like, Exxon's not going to come
yeah,
in.
Yeah, yeah.
Exxon's not like...
their name on. I don't even know. I honestly, I have no idea.
I have no idea what it even means.
It's not
for
like there's
America
like a marine there like taking selling the oil to Trafigura, and Trafigura is like, you know, washes it and like sells it to Glencore, and Glencore sells it to Shell,
yeah.
And next thing you know, it ends up in the U.S.
Yeah.
Something like that.
Gas
like,
prices go down. No,
yeah.
I don't know how the oil, what it means for us to take the oil, other than that, I guess we're...
guarding the oil fields.
We're guarding the oil fields.
But
presumably,
the oil,
there are production facilities
really
there
active.
That
the
are
oil's
active.
Going somewhere.
Oil's,
someone's getting paid.
Yeah.
Someone's
getting paid, and it's safe to say that American companies are getting a cut of it somehow.
Presumably.
And that's probably, and your point is, that might be better than some local PMU coming
or
in there.
Assad,
and being like,
you know, like Assad can use it to like build some more barrel.
What?
PMU.
PMU is the paramilitary unit in Iraq. I think that's what it stands for. It's like a little, these little militia groups.
It's like umbrella term to describe all these various militia groups.
Yeah, that have like political party. Yeah. Yeah.
So let's pivot to domestic politics. And we can transition the sense that going back to that initial accounting of the damage done, I think this is, overall, I feel like this was a win for Trump domestically.
I think the people are too confused to sort out winners. I think the left is saying, no, it was horrific foreign policy without offering any alternatives. And I think the right's saying, we did it. We deterred. We got the bad guy.
We killed that guy.
We get the oil. Fuck it. Yeah, let it ride.
No new wars. Life's good.
So I think, obviously Fox News is singing the praises. I don't know, if you look at the polls or anything.
If it's statistically relevant.
Yeah, it's is it as any more meaningful? Did it change anyone's mind in this country?
Did it move the needle in terms of electoral?
I don't think so.
Yeah.
I don't even know what changes people's minds in this country anymore, though. I mean, I do know, had we escalated to a point of a real war,
I think
that would have been a turning point.
So
for
in that sense,
voters.
Because he didn't get into a war, I think.
Yeah, it's not a loss.
It's not a loss. Certainly not a loss.
It's status quo almost. Chaotic Trump foreign policy.
I'd argue that
you're arguing that objectively, whether it changed minds or not, this was a foreign policy
win
for the United States because no war, bad guy gone.
Someone had it on the margin.
Iranian regime suffering.
Probably some neocons in Washington D.C. were like, "Yeah, this is kind of nice."
We were joking about John Bolton, just he's on the outside looking in.
He's like, "Wait, okay, I won't testify if you bomb Iran."
Yeah. You know what? I actually don't have bad things to say about Trump. Just hire me again, and let's get this thing going. I thought we were going somewhere.
Okay, so pivoting to domestics.
So Democrats are and this, I didn't watch the debate. You did. So you tell me what was...
This was right after this whole thing happened.
Right after this whole thing happened,
and
there wasn't a war.
Course,
what are the Democrats
CNN goes,
saying?
Care to comment. And, everybody's like, let's go back to the...
How was it framed? How did CNN frame it?
I missed the framing. Presumably it was atrocious.
Was it
and loaded.
Trump bad?
Yeah.
Trump bad, right?
Basically
yes,
the answer was...
Comment?
Yeah. Which, fair enough. But I felt like the answers were pretty juvenile,
know, in the sense that it's basically, Klobuchar, for example, was like, well, I would talk with Iran. I would talk, and we would get the deal done. Go back to the deal.
Everyone
wants to go back to the deal because, fair enough, that's a legitimate policy standpoint.
Then what?
But the deal's done. It's not there anymore. So...
We talked about it. I mean, I think there is an opportunity. So let's just say, the Democrats could get the deal
done. But no one said that.
Again.
No one said, no one went out there and well, Iran's under a lot of pressure right now. There's an opportunity. The old deal is done, and it had some drawbacks, but it had a lot of positives. And with the pressure that I will take, when I come on to play, I will give Iran an opportunity to come to the table by taking off Trump's sanctions and offer a fig leaf. Fig leaf.
Olive branch?
Olive branch. Thank you. Yeah. We'll edit that part out.
So everyone's
not
even get back in the old deal.
It was just I was just unimpressed. Now,
what did Pete say?
Pete's just I don't know. He just said, they all said they want to go back to the deal.
Everyone wants to go back to the deal that's dead.
I'm like, guys,
Everyone wants Iran to not have a nuclear weapon. Fine.
Though I did, I don't think anybody. I think most people. I think Pete was definitely pro. Soleimani's bad guy. We droned him. Nice.
Yeah. Well, I know. When it happened, all the candidates said stuff like, "This guy was really awful, but you shouldn't assassinate political figures from other countries."
Yeah.
That was sort of the.
And also,
the,
it's like the whole like
consensus that emerged. That was the left. There's always got to be a critique on Trump.
Yeah.
God forbid you say anything good about him. And, I don't mean, obviously, he's a horrific. It's pretty transparent how I feel. But it's incredible to me that you can't grant him any win. And he's done this to himself, too. It's just the nature of the domestic politics right now, where it's if you give Trump an inch, he'll take a mile.
Yeah.
So if Nancy Pelosi said, well, you know what? I don't agree with Trump on 99.9% of things, but I'm happy Soleimani's gone. Trump would have taken that shit and beaten every Democrat. So he doesn't allow you to give him credit.
Yeah.
And so by definition then, all the Democrats have to say everything he does is bad.
Yeah.
They have to come up with this weird framing of the issue where it's we don't want to say Soleimani was good because he's not. He's a bad guy. We are glad he's dead. we wish we didn't kill him in this way.
Yeah.
We wish we had killed him in the field of open combat, yeah. I guess.
Yeah, we should have started a war, a proper war, so that it was legit fair
or
target.
Or not kill him, but just keep killing the people under him,
yeah.
and engage in the proxy wars with
yeah.
the
militia. Oh, and also there's the whole thing, is like they have no...
There's no coherent...
And there's also no room to... You know, Obama's the king of drone strikes, right? Like,
yeah.
There's no room to be
I know,
like,
yeah, so you can't really like, well, it's bad that Trump's like using
can't,
drones.
Yeah, this is... He didn't even have the authorization of the Congress to do this strike. It's like...
That was something that came out of it that I thought was good, is that I saw Republican and Democratic leader... Well, so Democrats, I think, threw out a resolution on the House floor that was like, Trump needs to get our approval to go to Iraq. Non-bonding, binding resolution.
Yeah.
Nancy Pelosi's like, it has teeth because it comes from Congress. I'm like...
Also, like, sorry, bro, but this House doesn't get to decide foreign policy. It's like the Senate
yeah.
is the only one who votes on military.
Yeah.
Like, this House is legitimately, like, not relevant.
And there were some GOP senators who came out. Mike Lee came out. Not Mike Lee. Was it
yeah,
Mike
Lee.
Mike Lee and then
sounds like
Rand
something.
Paul.
Of course,
which,
yeah.
Which, you know, nice to see some consistent libertarian thought there. But they both came out and said, like, the briefing we got from the White House after the fact, after this assassination, was the worst briefing we've ever received.
Totally insufficient.
There was no justification for this. There's actually a pretty good case to be made in at The Hague or for like war crimes.
Yeah.
I think Iran is taking us to the International Criminal Court for a war crimes case
yeah.
like, by assassin. Not that like.
Good thing we boycott that shit.
Yeah, we don't yeah, we don't care about the International Criminal Court anymore.
Yeah,
we
make our own rules.
Yeah, we make our own rules. So anyway, so the Democrats are incoherently saying Trump bad. I would do better by doing something that Obama
totally,
did because
yeah.
Obama's good.
Yeah, totally. Yeah,
that's
basically what it comes
much
down
the policy.
To.
Policy. It's like I would go back to Obama era where we drone strike.
Which, to be fair, from a domestic consumption standpoint, for like, let's talk like, nomination process, right?
Yeah.
Foreign policy just does not factor into people's, like it does on the fringes in the sense that like people don't like war.
Yeah,
like,
that's all. That's the only.
That's the only.
Foreign policy
and so like obviously everybody's against going to war, so that's fine. Bring back our troops. Everybody wants to like spend less money on war and swords and the plowshares type shit. You know,
mm-hmm.
like that's like. That's pretty straightforward. Everybody's against it. The minutiae of foreign policy that we kind of like, for example, this talk through over the last hour.
Yeah.
There's absolutely no
appetite
for that conversation because, you know, most people can't even find Iran on a map, right? Like, so.
Yeah.
I don't think it necessarily hurts any of these nominees. It just is funny from our standpoint.
Yeah.
I think politically, so, I think the only thing I will say is that there is a sort of like, you know, like the ad, I think Hillary ran an ad at one point, like, it's 3 a.m., and they show the president waking up and picking up the phone. Like, who do you want to be the commander-in-chief type feeling?
Yeah.
Like, who do you trust with the butt, with the...
Yeah.
Now, clearly, to some degree, that's irrelevant since we gave it to the madman. but I do think that is a sense for some people. They take that into account.
They want a
like,
serious person.
They want
that's,
a serious
that's
person.
That's as much as people think about foreign policies. They want a serious person who is thinking about the issues that they don't want to think about.
Yeah. So
and
in that sense,
making the right decisions.
Who do you think benefits in that arena? Like, I believe, for example, that probably there's a lot of voters who say like they don't trust Bernie on that issue because he's such a like a you know ideological warrior. I do think a lot of people actually vote for Bernie on a foreign policy standpoint, though. The Bernie people love Bernie on that front
yeah, that's
because
the thing, is like
he's so anti-war.
The hard left is like very
so anti-war
into Bernie's foreign policy, and I would argue even.
But I think the center left very much is against
is
Bernie
against
for, that,
his foreign
for, that,
policy.
For that exact reason.
Yeah,
so there's like there's a conflict
yeah,
center
exactly.
around
and
Bernie.
I will say Bernie at least. I mean, you think he has no command of foreign policy, but I would say that he at least he speaks to it with a cohesive view in a way that I don't think like Biden has, for instance. Like I don't.
I think he has an ideologically cohesive in a sense.
Like he's got an ideology.
He's like
really. That's all it comes.
Yeah,
to
the ideology is like
idea.
War is bad. Pull out.
Yeah.
Like, you know, and like generic like
work with allies.
You know,
yeah.
which is like
don't tell countries how to run their governments. Like
so, yeah.
don't sanction people. Don't like drone strike people.
So
like,
and he's consistent on that. Like,
yeah.
He's been saying the same shit for however many decades. So he does have that. I think that speaks to a lot of people's concerns. I do think it's not the... I don't think it's like a big chunk of the party, though. I think it's like 50-50 maybe or something, where there's also the part of the party that
wants
very much
more,
is like kind of more generic institutional,
yeah.
you know, center-left. You know, Obama, Hillary, Biden style. I think Buttigieg is probably in there. Klobuchar, probably you'd see the same foreign policy from her. I think here's a good question is, where does Warren stand on that?
See, I think Warren doesn't she's a total foreign policy.
And she did. She fumbled the Iran question at first. Like, I felt like her question was like...
Can you remember any of the answer? What, like...
No, again, it was like, all that same stuff. But like, she just... It was not coherent. Like, you know how clearly articulate she is when she talks about healthcare?
Yeah.
Or some of these issues that she has a strong command of. Like, you can see, it's like whoa.
Corporate
it's
finance.
It's impressive. Right? You're like, whoa, this person knows what she's talking about. She's got her issues.
She's got policy prescriptions.
Yep. None of that. It's gone. You know, she looks like senile Biden trying to form a sentence. You know, like in the sense that she was not able to, and it was stark just because you're used to seeing her in such command of the issue.
Yeah.
It was like, whoa. Which I think is true. I think she probably just doesn't have experience in the foreign policy side, just objectively on her resume.
Yeah. What about Yang? Did he say anything interesting?
He wasn't on the debate.
He wasn't on the debate.
It was only Biden, Bernie, Warren, Klobuchar, Buttigieg, Owen, Tom Steyer, your
Tom
friendly
Steyer.
Neighborhood billionaire, was on the stage.
Andrew Yang, the Democrat.
Yeah. It's embarrassing for the Democrats that he's on there. And Andrew Yang isn't.
And so Mike Bloomberg's also involved, right? But he's just not participating in the debates, and he's just...
So the thing is, for Mike Bloomberg, the qualifying criteria is the number of individual donations. Like, you have to have some X number of individual donations, and he's got zero.
Yeah.
He's got one, which is his money.
Yeah,
he's spending his own.
He's spent $250 million so far.
Yeah, and he said he's willing to spend $1 billion to beat Trump of his own money.
And that's just like, I mean, we've talked about this before, but...
Which I'm like, honestly... Yeah.
Why aren't billionaires just spend $1 billion fixing the rainforest? Spend $1 billion on a highway.
Buy $1 billion worth of the Amazon.
Yeah.
Go do that right now.
Just preserve it.
And then spend $200 million a year on some private security force to guard it. You've done more for the climate than you will ever do as a president.
Yeah.
I mean, or I don't know, maybe not. Maybe that's
I mean,
too far.
Spend
more,
a,
yeah, you know,
spend $1 billion funding basic research for carbon
solar panels
capture.
And batteries tech.
Yeah, or energy tech. Yeah.
Like
whatever.
Please, but yeah, I totally agree. The billionaires, fuck, I hate them. I'm not a Bernie in this, but in that sense that that egomania that the only way for me to spend this money is for me to be the president.
Yeah, that's what's
needed. You know, it's
right
now. Take this $1 billion, shut up, and
go do something with it. If
go
I had
preserve
a $1 billion,
like,
do something.
If I had $1 billion, I would buy up all these beautiful ecological systems that I know are in danger of being, you know, just paved over with concrete, put a Walmart on it, and I would preserve them. I'm from Maine, Like in Maine, there's all these beautiful islands and ecosystems that you could just buy and preserve for perpetuity. Put into a trust and a conservation trust, and basically save that land for all of perpetuity from being developed.
Nah, election ads.
Yeah.
Nah,
it's frustrating.
About
I think that's such
ads.
Good use of that money. In some sense, it is. Obviously, you do want to create structural change, but it's.
Well, so let's go over. I mean, so we got the two billionaires who are running. They're obviously not going to win. I don't even think it's worth talking about. It's hilarious they're spending their money in this way. Really, I mean, Klobuchar, is there any real hope? Let me just go through the candidates. Klobuchar, any hope in your mind of her?
So
somehow,
she does poll reasonably well in Iowa. There's I think in Iowa now.
I think she's at 6 or something, though.
Yeah, but it's 20% up high with Biden and Bernie and Warren. And I think Buttigieg are kind of like...
Those
up
four are 20, 20, 16, 16.
Something like that, right?
Yeah.
Probably within the realm of, noise.
They're
going
to be first through fourth.
Probably. And then Klobuchar, of all everybody else, she is next up because she's just north of there is Minnesota.
Right.
And she's a senator from Minnesota. That's her territory. She has some sort of next door neighbor good feels, and also she just, that's her constituency to a certain degree. So I think she pulls above... Where she,
but it's not about she's like, people are fine with her, because I think people are fine with her, but is there any, is she going to win any primary?
Yeah, right?
Is she going to be the number one candidate?
So here's what I think would happen.
States?
Here, maybe her path to victory is, Biden's aging rapidly, there's a real chance, by the time we get to the next debate, he can't form a coherent sentence.
You said it was really bad on the
debate.
Dude,
I can't believe people are allowing him to go up there, it's so bad. Just from the beginning of the debate season, each debate he's gotten more senile.
It's really not good.
It's like
people. How is he still polling at 20? It's just people haven't watched anything. And they're he was the vice president. And they're still remembering clips from him in 2010.
He's like, it's
America is nothing without brand recognition.
Yeah,
and he is a brand. Biden is a brand.
And he got that Obama good feels. Passed on to
him. But it is he's losing that, right?
Obviously, he says enough stupid things. Eventually, you think it goes away. But
He comes.
He
down
also
with
just like
issues.
He looks like just like I'm watching. I'm like, dude, this guy cannot. He, you can see him as he speaks, doing that like that old the person thing where they're trying to like pull out the files from their database in their head.
Yeah.
And like use it to form this the idea and use to pick find the words and like. He can't. You can see him squinting, like struggling, maxing out the last of his neurons to like
string together, like
and like dude, it's like.
I always wonder how many times you can say "look" in one answer to a question.
Exactly. Yeah, that is look. His thing. He's like, look, listen, look. Here's what we gotta do. Listen here.
Like,
the thing of it is.
Yeah, it's so funny. If you know, he's a centrist candidate. He's generically centrist. So if he somehow stumbles.
He's still ahead in like a number of states. I mean, he could like win South Carolina, and his campaign's just gonna keep going.
He's probably the best chance of winning right now. Honestly, still.
I mean, I know polls will say that,
but we'll see what you know. I think you know we'll see to what degree these polls show up, right? Like we'll you know, it's like that's always the thing. It's like in Iowa, we'll see if he wins Iowa and he goes and he wins New Hampshire and then he fucking wins South Carolina.
God,
it's like yo, Biden 2020. Here we go. It's happening. So, it could very well shape up that way. I think in which case, if he does win, the vice presidential nominee is going to be crucial because it's going to be a Dick Cheney type situation where whoever is in that vice president seat, I think, is going to exert a lot of influence. And also, there's like a 50% chance they take over the presidency when he dies. just because, I mean, that's you know, it's kind of crude, but it's like he's old. So I think that's going to be interesting if that does happen.
So that's Biden. So he might have legs. It's really going to depend on these first three elections. I know he's pulling ahead in South Carolina still. I think
he's competitive in Iowa, New Hampshire.
Iowa, he dropped to number two. Now I've seen it, I think, as of today, on Monday.
Bernie has made a gap. He's past Warren. He's like statistically significantly like trending higher than her in the polls.
I think Warren, Lauren and I will like watch Young Turks to like catch up on stuff, and like their whole take on Warren's
she's a wolf in sheep's clothing.
Yeah, is that she pivoted away from like her progressive base, that she was like, I'm the young, like
I'm the progressive.
More like mechanistic progressive. Biden or Bernie's just like the ideologue.
Yeah,
and
I've
so,
got
like,
plans for that.
I've got plans and blah, blah, blah. And now she's sort of pivoted away from that and has now been doing some more like generic campaign, like mainstream campaign shit, trying to be more of a centrist, I think, a bit. And now it's like you're in no man's land.
Yeah.
Right? Like you started on the hard left and now you're trying to run as a sort of progressive centrist. Yeah, truly.
Forget that.
Is that true? I always hear Bernie people say that.
Yeah.
She used to be a Republican.
Well, which I think that's okay.
That's
fine.
There's nothing wrong with.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But it's just like her identity's confused. Both her like literally her cultural identity, which she's confused herself.
Her ancestral identity.
Ancestral identity, but also her political identity. She came out of Oklahoma. She started as a Republican. Now she's like, oh, I'm hard left, and I vote with Bernie, and I'm all on Medicare for All, and now it's like, no, I'm a centrist. I'm like Obama, except, you know, I'm going to run right down the middle, but I'm not Pete.
So we'll. I mean, I think
Mayor Pete seems to have died, right? Like
he had a moment, and then he's backed off. He was in the lead in the Iowa and New Hampshire polls at one point, and he's backed
off. People
just
were like, no.
He's still up there, though. He's ahead of Klobuchar, for example.
It seems like to me, and then there's been this Bernie Elizabeth Warren drama in the interwebs with them. Hating each other, fighting each other.
The whole lie
you're
thing.
You're calling me a liar. Shit. I mean.
Scandal.
Yeah. It seems
CNN
to me it's
going
to be Bernie Biden, which is sort of like.
I mean, I can't believe it.
I know.
It's two geriatric old white men.
Yeah.
And this is the best the Democratic Party of the nation has.
I think it's gonna be Bernie, dude. Now that I'm
and then it becomes Bernie because realistically, I feel like Biden can't win the presidential. He can't do it. He hasn't done any.
I will say Bernie Trump debates, general election debates, must see TV.
Yeah, that's gonna be
absolute must see.
But
TV.
Also,
honestly, the general election debates in general.
But
I'm super
I will. I think that will be the end of the podcast because I will have to say goodbye to humanity and civilization. Like,
if you're watching Bernie versus Trump,
like United States, like. The great beacon of the free world, whatever, blah, 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 blah. Like, this is the last, the best hope for humanity is, like, this, of is, whatever. And the civilizational crisis, global warming, blah, 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 end of cap, what? And this is what we get.
We got two 80-year-olds.
This is the best we can do. This is what we've,
out of the like the ground sourcing of our people, you know, through the process of political nomination, and you know, this is like the people do choose. You know, the people are choosing this. This is what the people are bringing, and we got Bernie and Trump.
That's really it.
That's the best we can do.
Yeah, that's it. There's no one.
It's sad. It's tragic. I'm sorry. It's tragic.
Yeah.
I mean, we'd like to think that it's the people who are choosing this, but it's not really the people who are choosing this. It's like the people who are rising in the polls are the people who have the backing of all these major corporations and all
and
these
the money. But Bernie has the money. I mean, he's got.
Well, he did the crowd search for him.
People love Bernie. The people
do actually love Bernie. That is true.
And you know, and like the people love Trump. You know, like not.
Yeah.
You know,
Trump's people.
Trump's people love Trump. That's a good. I mean, it may not be more than 50%, but it's a good chunk of the country.
And that's all it is now. Is like you just got to energize your 30% of the nation.
And like, it's just like, how civilizationally did we get here? Where
my friend Tom sent me an article. I think I sent it to you. I don't know if you read it. It was in Foreign Policy.
I did. I read.
So I thought that was a really interesting take. That like the mechanistic downfall of our country, something the founders thought about but didn't put any like sort of mechanism in place to get rid of. It's the two-party system.
Yeah.
Having these two monolithic parties where, like we were just talking about with like how the Democrats have to formulate an opposition to Trump's foreign policy.
And the Republicans, it's either you're sycophantic, yes man, or you're not
in the party.
Yeah.
Yeah, and that's really it. It's like you're either in the, like the rural, like, America first, like fuck immigrants, like all in on Jesus, guns, like climate change is bullshit, we need a strong leader, we need to like go out there and take the oil and just be great and be fucking American and stop being, you know, lower taxes, whatever, or you're on Bernie's side, right? And it's just like all cities, Trump country is retarded, like we need universal health care, we need like high taxes on the rich, green revolution. Everything has to be filtered through these two monolithic parties. And yeah, what you get is like two uninspiring candidates, maybe.
And
if you had a multi-party system, if you had a green party who was like, they're the green people. You want that's your number one thing? You vote green.
Yeah.
You don't have to vote for the Democrat.
And there's like a little libertarian party.
There's a libertarian party. There's a centrist party.
There's like an anti-immigrant party.
There's,
you know?
Yeah, there's an anti-immigrant party. There's a multinational, like cosmopolitan city party, right?
Yeah.
How does that play out when you're voting for one presidential candidate?
So on the presidential candidate, it's interesting because, ultimately it does filter down to one. But at least really what that does is that empowers...
We'll post the link to the article in the description.
It talks about how if you're in the city, it doesn't really make sense to vote because you know you're going to be Democrat and your vote is, you know, it doesn't really matter because everyone's voting Democrat. And if you're in the rural area, you're not going to be able to win any popular vote, but like you're, again, it's like everyone's...
So, and I think also the article is fascinating because it kind of outlines all these mechanistic changes, you know, that we could change to... Without overwriting everything, that we could change to kind of
election mechanics, really.
Election mechanics that
to allow coalition building.
Yeah, ranked choice voting, for example, doing away with the Electoral College, one popular vote for the presidency. I think it's fascinating. It's like seems to be a little bit more just like intellectual cheese because I am skeptical of it.
Yeah,
of structural reform
at
that scale.
You're promoting the results of our current system, and I don't know how we. I don't know how we get out of this.
No,
right?
I mean,
like,
this is like...
We're not... It seems like we're just going to keep going down this road because, you know what? No matter whether Bernie... Let's say Bernie wins. He does his new Iran deal. He, like, starts...
Green New Deal.
He puts vegetables back in school lunches. He does universal health care. He raises taxes on billionaires. Green New Deal. Yeah, all this shit.
Life's good.
Like, the hard left... I mean,
it's
like,
it's not going away. It's just going to be, like, next election is going to be just as toxic over some other set of issues. Like,
and it's
going to
be Ted Cruz versus, you know, AOC or Don Jr. versus...
Why, every podcast we get to this state of resignation. We talk ourselves to this, like, state of resignation.
Yeah, where the country is just like, this is what we are now. And we've entertained... I don't know what it is, whether it's like we've entertained ourselves to death, whether we have it too good, we don't struggle enough, like, we don't... There's not a political thought happening within the electorate. There's no reaching across the aisle. There's no let's debate these issues.
Yeah.
There's no like,
and we seem
let's
to be on
find a... consensus on like issue on an issue by issue basis rather than I'm on this team or that.
Yeah,
team.
I think that's a great this article we're referencing talks about that as well. That inability of it's
every issue is every issue, right? In the sense that it's either we debate all of these issues at once, or we don't, or we don't do anything at all. So it's like there's no ability to just say like, oh, on this issue I'm here, but on this issue I'm here. You know, on
yeah,
this
there's
stuff,
none of that.
There's no ability. For
and even
people
if people have that in their private lives,
yeah.
they don't vote that way,
yeah.
and the politicians don't
vote that way.
So it
that.
Doesn't matter whether people actually.
I believe one of my things is I do believe that some of this is coming from the fact that we have. It's very much winner take all.
Yeah.
Like the country has centralized. Partially due to technology, but I also
yeah.
think the institutions have slowly, the federal level institutions have become where everything takes place. And so in the past where states had more power in the sense that like more of like your day-to-day life was influenced by state level decision making.
Yeah.
The national result wasn't everything
yeah.
and therefore wasn't as combative, right? I guess I you know, so as we've centralized and the imperial presidency has ascended as the one thing that rules everything.
Yeah.
It's gotten more and more toxic and winner take all and polarized and whatever. Whereas in the past, maybe as we were decentralized, you know, more federal, you know, more spread out decision making was more disaggregated.
And this goes into some of the damage that like Trump has done too. By
yeah.
like he found the cheat code and he did the like I found my 30% that I'm just going to lean in too hard. Turns out I don't need the rest of the 70% of the country. I'm just going to cater exclusively to this group, and my candidacy, you know what it's about? It's about fucking winning.
Yeah.
That's it. It's just about winning.
Yeah.
And so if you're on the left, I'm trying to make you lose.
Yeah.
Everything you do.
And if you want to be on the winning side, like, we're going to win.
We're going to win, and it's all about that. I mean, he was like, down to like, I've been talking about this with a bunch of people, but like,
he's done
spiteful shit. Like, he literally repealed Michelle Obama's school lunch program
yeah.
for fighting obesity with like vegetables and stuff in the meals and less pizza and shit. He literally repealed that on her birthday.
Yeah, it's like
that's just like he's literally just pandering to his base. That's
yeah.
not that the consensus building or like
that's,
did
yeah.
I think did he think
like,
through that policy?
That is just like fundraising.
Yeah,
like he like, generates fundraising from that. And,
yeah,
like,
he generates enthusiasm if not money.
Yeah,
just by being like yeah, fuck Michelle Obama. That's like the lane he's driving in. And you know what? The Bernie Sanders is just going down exactly like fuck Trump.
Yeah.
Right. Like,
which is whatever.
That's what our country is now.
Yeah, and you know, I mean, it's like also like I laughed because Pelosi on the impeachment order.
Oh yeah,
let's
get into impeachment before
yeah.
we wrap up.
Okay, so Paul.
Yeah.
Quick.
The impeachment order.
What's our updated hot take on best? Who's going to win the nomination?
I think Bernie wins the nomination now.
Yep,
it's like,
that's where you are.
I thought Elizabeth Warren when we first started doing this, I think, and now I think Bernie wins.
Yep, okay.
That's just my prediction.
I think my prediction right now is Biden, unfortunately.
How about actual choice or pseudo-endorsement?
Who's the... Oh, ooh.
That's good. Who would I endorse? See, I hesitate to do this, but
I endorsed Bernie last podcast, I think.
Yeah, because you want to test his policies out.
I just
wanted
to experiment.
I would like, you know, on a personal level, obviously I want more investment in renewables. I would love a humbler foreign policy with less wars. You know, I would I'm going issue by issue because that's how I like to think about stuff.
What's your endorsement?
If I had to endorse someone right
now. You got to vote for somebody. It's like, it's do or die.
It's really tough.
You can always vote for Trump too.
Yeah, wouldn't be him. I don't think it would be him.
It's okay. I won't hold it against you.
I appreciate you giving me that safe space to say that. Yeah. Let the record show that on January 21st, 2020, Trevor Safko did not endorse Trump. So it'd probably be... See, I think... I don't know. I think Bernie. I want to see like I want to see some of those policies, but there's a huge part of me that wants to say Andrew Yang.
Yeah.
Because I like
really?
I like the idea of a political outsider.
Yeah.
I like the idea of I like he's just more he's got a
well,
perspective.
He's younger. Like,
he's got a perspective on like actual like
really
issues
life.
Facing
yeah.
the modern economy from automation to
yeah.
like.
And he doesn't speak in political rhetoric.
I
hate political rhetoric.
He's got creative policy subscriptions. I don't think Bernie has. Bernie's policy subscriptions are like tried and true from like the 50s,
yeah.
whether they work or not, whether they can work in 2020,
yeah.
you know, raise taxes on the rich, try to pour some funding on in
yeah,
into like
universal healthcare,
social safety nets and stuff.
Yeah.
I hope that shit works, man. That'd be great. Yeah, maybe everyone lives it. We build a utopia in the in Bernie's political movement together. As I grow older and older, I get more and more skeptical, and I just doubt that he has the ability, or any president really has the ability to, like,
institute that.
So I kind of want more of a modern thinker about and thinking about modern issues rather than trotting out 20th century, you know, FDR shit.
I wish we could hear more of Andrew Yang's policies.
I know,
it's not allowed in the debate stage.
It's not on the debate, like, and it's like, and even saying, like, endorsing Andrew Yang, what does that even mean? It's like,
yeah,
he's not going to win.
What does that mean?
Well, it's like, same thing as, like, endorsing Cory Booker. It's like,
so I do think, I want to go to Lauren next, but I want to do a quick side note. The Democratic debates, right, there's these set of rules. To be fair, the Democratic committee leadership set up these set of rules that made by which people qualify for the debates, and Andrew Yang didn't qualify. Sad story. This is what I think. I think the Democratic leadership say, we're fucking choosing for the good of the party.
Yeah.
And I'm going to take that on the chin. I'm going to take responsibility for this party and what it should be, and I'm going to pick who's on these debates. Sorry, Marianne Williamson, you're not getting on the debate stage.
Yeah.
We're going to have good candidates that I choose because I think they represent the party and the various views and the various... And I... Sorry, you know, Tom Steyer, you're not getting on a debate stage. Andrew Yang is. Like,
I mean, but they wouldn't... Because wouldn't allow an Andrew Yang.
So, but I do think... Sure, they maybe... They wouldn't because that's... And that's why... There's no political leadership.
Yeah.
The leadership of the Democratic Party should have taken responsibility and owned this debate and said... And the whole process, they should have said... You elected me the DNC, the chairman of the DNC. I'm going to execute on this, and I'm going
to
take.
That's what they tried to do with Hillary versus Bernie in 2016,
and that was a failure because they did it.
They
did take responsibility. And they chose Hillary,
yeah,
which was bad. That's bad leadership. They should have had an honest debate from the get go between Hillary and Bernie.
But they didn't want that, right? Because that's the thing, is the Democratic
choose, but they choose poorly. You know, like, history hinges on, like, people taking responsibility and choosing poorly or well, and I think they choose...
Why should we take the choice away from the people, though?
No, I don't think we're taking away from the choice. I just think they basically tried to shed responsibility by creating these sets of rules ahead of time.
Yeah.
And it's like lettering it happen, say, hey, these are the rules.
Yeah.
You know, so...
Like,
it's turned out poorly. Now we have Tom Steyer in the debate stage.
How did he get enough donations? How did he get enough individual?
He has a big fundraising network, and I guess because he used to be an organizer before he became a candidate. So I just think that's a failure of political leadership of the political class there. Side note, back to the main topic, Lauren. Who's your we're gonna be able to change. You're gonna be able to change your future podcast.
Bernie, where we are right now, and I would hope that he would pick a vice president that would stand for the same ideals, but is younger and more in tune with, like, tech and the modern economy. You know, I do like Andrew Yang in the sense that he kind of appeals to the younger generation, but I still honestly don't really know what he stands for. I don't know how he plans on executing his policies, and I don't know if he really understands the way that government works.
The political mechanics.
In the way that we would want him to as the leader of our country.
So Bernie Yang.
Yeah.
Bernie Yang. You'd have a Bernie Yang ticket.
Maybe. I mean, I would like to maybe even see someone who's not even on the stage right now.
Yeah,
someone else who actually
does happen, that does happen.
Like,
they do pull.
I mean, Tim Kaine.
Tim Kaine.
I mean, I would love a woman and person of color being in the leadership stage of the country, but that's clearly not an option right now. So,
I mean, it's an option. It's an option that leadership and...
I endorse...
As of right now, as of the options that have been put before us.
Yeah.
I think I endorse Warren. I think she has the guts to, you know, speak truth to Trump on the debate stage.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
I think she's ideologically flexible enough to unite the party.
Yeah.
To beat Trump,
yeah,
and to also not even after they beat Trump, but also unite the party when they have the Senate and get stuff passed, like, you know, like when
I don't
get
know,
stuff,
man. I think that hyper partisanship is here to stay for until Trump.
You know,
dies.
I mean, sure, the partisanship between the parties, but like within the party.
I was fully on
Warren
as of 2 weeks ago, maybe.
Yeah.
And I was like, I don't know if she has.
And also, honestly, she bought my vote. She said she's going to use an executive order to raise federal debt.
Well, she said that. She also said.
So yeah, so like, I'm like trying to get her to.
She's saying like, oh yeah, maybe on my second term.
Yeah.
What
so
about
I'm.
Those private ones though. Millions of people have.
Well, hopefully she'll be think of that too. I mean, she's got a plan for everything, right? So that's my coin endorsement. It's honestly bought and paid for by that promise. So
yeah.
Principles out the window. And two, I do think I want to see Medicare for all experimentally. I personally think it's going to be not. I think it's good for the country in the sense that I think we need a solution and we need a fix. I don't think it's going to fix a lot of the problems, and I think in 15, 20, 30 years in the road, what we're going to see is that...
a whole different suite of problems in all likelihood.
Yeah, it's like kind of how, the NHS, problems just... Problems never go away.
I think people are tired of our current set of problems. Normally it's devil you know versus devil you don't.
Yeah.
I think people want the devil you don't.
Yeah, so and we're going to get it.
I'm tired of the fact that, I don't have a job, I don't have health care.
Yeah.
People are tired of the fact that, if I have a baby, it's going to cost me how much? 10 grand?
Yeah.
10 grand to have a fucking baby?
Well, yeah.
That's like a real thing in this country. That's just not in other countries. You don't incur tens of thousands of dollars in medical debt just for giving life to producing a human, something we've done for free our whole lives, or our whole species existence. So all these sorts of American healthcare problems, I think people are tired of them. They want a new set of healthcare problems,
it's going to be something.
I can't get this experimental surgery
or whatever it is. The federal debt balloons and we have to raise taxes.
Oh, yeah, now we care about federal debt. Is there anyone voting on fiscal policy right now?
I, of course, as the reactionary, honestly, I'm trolling everybody because I don't like any of the Democratic candidates. I hate them all, including Bernie. Actually, and I'll also say, I was willing to do the Bernie experiment last podcast episode, because I was fed up. I was like,
what changed?
I saw him on the debate stage, and he's insufferable. When he's on the debate stage, and he's yelling and screaming, and he's like...
Elizabeth is back in front of
me. Yeah. I just am like, honestly, I would never want to work with this guy.
Do you want to share your take?
He's insufferable.
I know people who have worked with him personally and are not a fan of Bernie.
Not okay.
They say that he is on his moral high ground and he pretends to be better than everyone else, when in reality he is just as dirty as all the other politicians.
Yeah, and he exudes that
that
self-righteousness that
was
I'd rather you be cynical like Trump. like Trump is... He's like, I'm a scumbag, but I win.
Really telling that, in the 2016 election, all the people who were, so fervently for Bernie very quickly switched to Trump.
Yeah.
I don't understand.
There was a huge thing there where there's,
the Bernie bros.
And also, I do think, I also think some of Bernie's language is very anti-immigrant. He doesn't say it explicitly, but, everything is about... us shipping jobs overseas and taking jobs. Like, I'm sorry, but if taking jobs is your primary concern, it's only a tiny step to build the wall. It's true that it's very close, and so I don't. He's like, NAFTA, Mexico took 7 billion jobs. Oh, 7 million jobs. It's like, yeah, and the Mexicans got them. Like, do we just say fuck the Mexicans? Like, they want they're benefiting from those jobs. Like, it's complicated, right?
We can't be the only country benefiting from.
Yeah, it's like there's no recognition of that complexity, which I just. It's not that any politician gives recognition to the complexities of an issue, but Bernie does that, and then he adds in his righteousness, his moral righteousness.
Yeah.
It's insufferable. I still would be, if he got elected, I wouldn't be upset because I do want to see the experimental.
At this stage for me, I'm not looking, I'm so cynical about any candidate.
I just need Trump to lose. I really just need Trump to lose.
I need Trump to lose. I can't.
I'm voting on. Climate change stance is really important to me also.
Yeah, it's like, there's that's what I'm looking for right now.
That is a huge opportunity economically,
paradigm shift for sure.
Yeah, that's what I'm looking for. Is not like a candidate who's like checks all the boxes and can understand foreign policy and can, because I just feel like that's a pipe dream.
Do
this
you think
never going to produce that? I'm looking for a win on a few key issues. I'm looking for funding for basic research and climate change and trying to actually approach that issue seriously, as well as sort of increase in social safety nets and. Reduction in income inequality. Those are the two major things that I would like domestically to see.
On the voting thing here,
as well as no wars.
Do you think that it's relevant, it's legitimate to vote based on who has the best chance to beat Trump? So what I mean by that is, do you think it's basically like we're set, Trump's going to lose, or do you think it's like prioritizing that above all else is a legitimate like voting concern for a voter? Like, I actually like Bernie more than I like person, you know. I actually like Bernie more than I like Biden, but I think Biden's the best chance to beat Trump, therefore I'm voting for Biden. Like, to what degree do you think that it's legitimate and necessary for like the Democratic voters to do?
I guess I reject the... I think that Trump is much more beatable than he seems.
Yeah.
I think he's got like...
So you don't... So therefore, if he's...
I think
it doesn't really matter, really. You
know? That's what I think. It doesn't really matter.
I guess
I do,
the question is, what cost? Like,
well, I mean, that's my thing is, like, I would literally vote for any of the candidates there. Like, if the cost is, like, Warren versus Biden, like, or, you know, like, Biden versus, like,
I think a primary should vote.
Biden's, like, not going to be as good as Bernie on those things where you guys were just talking about. Like, he's just not going to push green. He's not, whatever. He's not going to push those issues the way Bernie would, but I would much rather that than another 4 years of Trump.
Yeah.
Without, hands down, 10 out of 10, done, easy, no problem. I'll take that trade.
Yeah, I think it's... I don't know if that's the choice, though. I don't think that it's like...
And framing it that way is kind of, you know, unfair.
Yeah, I mean, a lot of people do think of it that way. A lot of people look at, like, head-to-head numbers. But I think... I mean, who knows, man? I mean, if anything Trump taught us,
it's
like polls are nonsense. But
yeah, how do you even define electability?
Yeah.
If we're not going to talk about the issues.
Yeah.
I think when you get into the electability lane,
it's
like becomes self-fulfilling prophecies of like mediocrity and like
I do
nothing
think,
changing.
Yeah.
And we there's such serious structural issues.
I kind of like electability because it does seem to be a mechanism by which people get pushed to the center. Which is, if you're into kind of like centrist, cool, take the temperature down. On that tangent we were on earlier about like why are we polarizing, why is it getting that does seem to be a mechanism at play where that electability thing kind of like pushes people to the center.
Unless Trump just killed that. And now it's just like, no, actually Trump proved you don't need to ever go to the center.
Yeah.
You just stay in your lane. You stay in your base.
Yeah.
And you just
move the party to you. You know,
move
he basically
the party to you,
yeah, which is crazy, yeah.
TBT, when you said that there should be serious legal consequences for people who got abortions.
Oh, I mean, he said women should go to jail for getting abortions or should be...
Trump did?
Yeah.
This
that
was
like, during the
election.
He's like, yeah, I think there should be a punishment for the woman. Not like in a Stephanopoulos interview where someone was like, just throwing out crazy stuff and he doesn't know the answers to like simple questions.
So he just
says
like,
what's
wrong?
He kind of backtracked and was like, or, you know, I don't know, maybe women, but maybe the doctors. Because
he really
isn't
like ideologically like,
he
just
not thought through anything.
Yeah, and also I don't really think ideologically, personally, he gives a shit about abortion.
No,
he's probably like, he's pro-abortion, I'm sure, because he's
definitely
probably...
had...
Yeah, he's paid for, like...
All
of
his mistresses.
Yeah,
like,
so it seems to me like that probably he's just like, oh, yeah, this will go well.
This will play well. Yeah, I just want to sound tough. Yeah, yeah, kill the... You gotta, you know, we can't just go after the terrorists. We gotta go after their families.
Yeah.
He says shit like that all the time where everyone's like, wait, you're saying we gotta kill innocent people? Yeah, yeah, you gotta go after the terrorist families. That's the problem. So we're out of time, but let me just say on the impeachment note, Nancy Pelosi used how many pens to sign the impeachment?
Oh, right. Sorry, we're digression left and right here today. 20-something.
20 pens. She used 20 pens.
It was something, maybe, I don't know.
What?
It was something.
It's because each pen was a part of her signature,
and it
can then be like
fundraised
off or like given to someone as like, this was a pen that impeached Donald Trump.
And then they fundraising. She didn't invent this. Everybody does this on big bills and stuff like that. It's pretty standard. But the number of pens was like unusually like this
new
is
pen record.
Yeah, I think. Or something like that. It was kind of a minor flap, you know. Of course Republicans are like, look at Nancy, she's so partisan, blah blah blah. And Democrats are like, this, you know, whatever. It is historic. But that is hilarious. Impeachment is proceeding. I think next episode, maybe we'll do an impeachment update, just because we haven't talked about it in a while.
Yeah, I mean, I don't even know if the nation cares anymore, but yeah, Trump did.
It's starting again tomorrow.
It's getting televised, right?
It's getting televised. Yeah, we'll see.
It's
like,
good television, yeah.
If we get Bolton up there and
hey, at the least we have good
shit.
Television. We got that going for us.
Yeah.
If Bolton gets on there, here's your take for next episode. Will Bolton testify or not? Yes or no? One yes or no? That's it.
Yes.
Yes. I say yes, you will. I want to say no
just because.
Honestly, I you know. Yeah, we'll see. We'll see. Maybe something happens and he gets removed from office.
Dude, dare to dream.
You never know. You just never know.
What if Trump just has a Big Mac heart attack? Who knows, man? That could happen like right before the general election.
2020.
Oh, no.
All right. Well, we'll see you next week.